Well, hello, church family. I'm glad that I get to share with you in this video and just kind of recap what we talked about this past weekend. We talked about viewing church as a family and not a business. And sometimes we just have to slightly shift our view on things. And that's what I wanted to talk about this weekend, was proposing we shift our view of the church. We talked about my son viewing the solar eclipse this past week, and we took him out of school and he was excited to see it, but he knew he couldn't look at the sun. And in the car, the sun was shining on his leg and he started to freak out because he didn't want to look at the sun. We assured him that it would be okay. And once we got home, he put on those glasses, and all of a sudden the way he interacted with the sun was completely different. Before the glasses, he interacted with the sun in fear. And after the glasses, it was in awe and amazement. And so when we view the church as a family, not a business, it means that there's a certain expectation of how we interact with the church in that way. And so what is the difference? Well, I gave an example of my wife who got her drink at Starbucks made wrong, and she asked me if I could take it back to get it remade. And so when I took it back, you know, I wasn't a jerk about it, but I had a certain expectation as a person who's bringing my business to Starbucks. You know, I expected them to listen to me and to make the drink correctly and to have good customer service. And in fairness to them, they did, and they even gave me a gift card, so it was a good treat. But when I interact with Starbucks or a restaurant for that matter, you know, there's a certain expectation. And if I had those expectations when I went home, it wouldn't work. So the example I gave was, what if I went home and treated my home like it was Starbucks? And you know, I got to the dinner table and my wife gave me my drink and I took a sip and I said, you know what, babe? I think it needs a little more ice. The temperature on this drink isn't quite right. And when you're done, you know, just call my name. I'll be over here on the couch with my phone. It wouldn't work. In fact, probably what would happen would she say, the freezer is there, go get your own ice and take the trash out while you're at it. We just don't treat our family the same as we treat a business or a restaurant. I don't treat my home like a hotel. At a hotel, I can leave my trash out, not make my bed, and I know that someone's gonna come in the next day and clean it up for me. In fact, I might even be upset if they didn't, because it's the expectation I have. But I don't have that expectation at home. Now, maybe if you have kids, they might treat your home like a restaurant or a hotel, but that's a different lesson. So when we view church as a family and not a business, why is that a good thing? And what does the Bible say about that? We read a verse in Ephesians, and I'm not going to read the whole verse in this message, but you can go back and refer to it, and talks about spiritual maturity. It talks about the body of Christ coming together and using the gifts so that love is promoted and God is glorified. And so the three reasons why church should be a family and not a business is this. Reason number one, you will never reach your potential without family. That's true in the natural. That's true in the spiritual. I have three boys, and you know, taking care of my boys is wild. There's a lot of wrestling matches going on at my house, and they take constant care and supervision and nurturing. And if they didn't have me or my wife, it would be bad. It would be very bad. But we do expect that at some point they can take care of themselves and even raise children on their own. You know, family is God's design. Family is the foundation of civilization. And we need family to speak into each other's lives, to help correct and to help steer in the right direction and to help encourage and to help call out the gifts in each other and to help love and support. Family is so important, and you'll never reach your potential in your life without family. And that's why we do life groups. That's why we worship together. That's why we pray together. That's why we gather together, because we realize there is a great need for even spiritual moms and dads to come alongside of us and help steer us in the right direction. So as our scripture verse says in Ephesians, we become ultimately more and more like Christ. This brings me to my next point, which is this, that family makes everybody better. And so when I say that, what I mean is we all contribute to family so that everybody wins, so that in a spiritual sense, ultimately, God is glorified. I gave a couple stories on this past weekend just doing that. And really, there's two parts to this. There's one, your shape, your unique gifting that God has given you and how you use that to contribute to the church and to the family of God. And then on the other part of that, there's where you just contribute however you can because you want there to be success. You want everyone to win. And so I told a story of my family on the 4th of July. You know, we all get together and we have this huge party. And one of our traditions, which I don't understand why it's a tradition, but it is that we make homemade ice cream. And at least we could get like an electric ice cream maker, but we don't even have that. We have this, my mom has this like 50-year-old ice cream hand crank maker that us boys every year, that's our job, what we do. We sit on this thing and we just turn this thing over and over until the ice cream gets cold. And we do that, one, because my 80-year-old grandfather would do it if we didn't do it, and two, because we just want the 4th of July to be the best event ever. And so if that's how we can contribute to make it happen, that's what we do. And it's funny, but we don't think of family and in a business sense because we don't see this corporate ladder. It's not like I'm churning the ice cream thinking one day I'm going to be over there, you know, lighting the fireworks or something like that. And in the same way in the church, I don't think the person passing out the bulletins is looking at me on stage while I'm leading worship saying, one day that microphone is mine. No, we don't do that because family, there's no corporate ladder. It's just we're just playing our part and doing what we can so that we pull everything off and it is awesome and we have a great service or a great event, and so that people feel loved and valued and our guests feel welcomed, and so that they know and feel the love of Jesus in their lives. So church as a family means we contribute however we can. My last point is that a healthy kingdom family is what is going to change the world. You know, no laws or policies or government can ultimately change the world, but a family, God's family, that is representing the heart of God, representing the heart of God to this world, is going to make history and is going to change this world. And if we can do it right, man, it's going to be incredible. So I believe that one of the most attractive things to this world is a healthy family. There's so much discord and dissent going on right now, even within our country. But there's something I know that everybody has in common, and that's this. Everybody has a desire to matter, to be known, and to be loved. And if someone could come into a church and see a group of people really living that out, really living out a kingdom family where they're willing to lay down their lives for each other, they're greeting and welcoming and contributing joyfully, and they're becoming more and more like Jesus, that is an attractive thing. That's something somebody wants to belong to. A kingdom family can change this world. You know, churches can have fancy lights and big screens and slides that go into the kids area, but the truth is, there is no love, then it all means nothing. The Bible says, without love, you're just a clanging cymbal. The Bible also says that Jesus says, you will know who my disciples are by the way that they love. And so when people come in and they know that there is a family who loves them, it changes everything. I was inspired by my wife, Danielle, and I told this story in church, but you know, she just really committed to this view of viewing church as family. And so now when she comes to church, she doesn't just sit in her spot and worship for her own, but as she worships, she's praying for the people around her. When she's sitting down, she makes at a point to get to know the person next to her, their name, and to just to learn about them. She wants to treat the church like everyone here is her family. And when we have that mindset, it just changes how we interact with the church, doesn't it? Can you imagine if everyone came in and just treated it like their home? There's no way they're going to let guests come in and not let them feel welcome. They're going to go and welcome them and get to know them and make sure that they feel loved and valued. And if we have a church who is just embracing this and owning it and living like a healthy family, man, I just believe that people's lives will be changed and people will want to come and be a part of the family. And what we learned in that verse is as we come and we're a part of the family, we're maturing, we're growing, we're becoming more like Jesus. And the more people there are like Jesus, the more this world is going to be impacted and changed for the better. So I encourage you, what does it look like for you? What's the next step you can take to live this out, to interact with the church as it is a family? God bless you guys.